Democrats divided over a resolution condemning anti-Semitism, seen as a rebuke of Democratic Congresswoman Ilhan Omar's controversial comments. Now, a meeting of House Democrats today behind closed doors reportedly turning contentious as new members confronted House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and other leaders, accusing them of rushing the resolution. So what does former Democratic vice presidential nominee Joe Lieberman think of all this? He joins us now. Sir, it's an honor to have you.
Thank you, Charles. Good to be here.
This is really worrisome because you've got some upstarts who have just come to Congress with chips on their shoulders, and it's all playing out in the public, and it's very ugly. What's your thoughts about all of this?
First thing is that words matter, and when people say words that are biased, bigoted, and hurtful to another group of people, another group of Americans, they have to be condemned quickly, or else it takes hold. And that I'm not only thinking about anti-Semitism, I'm thinking about racism, I'm thinking about any kind of bigotry toward any religious group or any other group. So I think this is a time of testing for the House of Representatives, and if I may, it's really a moral test about how clearly they will speak out in this case against what Congresswoman Omar said, which was clearly anti-Semitic.
And she's only been there a short period, and this is not the first time this issue has come up.
That's true.
So Nancy Pelosi, Steny Hoyer, the leadership, it feels like every day that this is delayed, the more they tweak this, the more it evolves into somehow, in my mind, to water down or mitigate the damage that was done by this particular congresswoman, I think the more they fail your moral test.
Well, that's why I think it's really important for the House to act and to act directly. I mean, it sounds like the resolution that they're drafting now, which was originally against anti-Semitism, although clearly it was engendered by what Congresswoman Omar had said, is being broadened to be also a statement against anti-Muslim bias. Of course, we should make that statement, but I think the House could do better. And if it was up to me, I'd say, okay, put out a foundational resolution condemning all forms of bigotry, and particularly saying that if members of the House of Representatives, elected members of Congress, get involved in that kind of bigotry, they're going to be specifically condemned by their colleagues who won't tolerate it. And then to pass another resolution if they want specifically condemning, criticizing Congresswoman Omar for her anti-Semitic comments. That's the best way to deter the next member of Congress of either party that says something that's racist or homophobic or anti any religious group.
It feels like in Washington, D.C., that, borrow a boxing term, the marquee, the Queensberry rules, no hitting behind the head. There's certain rules, certain laws of civility, even in a brutal sport like that, that they vanished a long time ago. But to watch them vanish within a political party where you have the upstarts who are very vocal about their feelings and they take the social media, but nothing seems to be slowing them down, and their resolve only in fact seems to grow greater and greater when there's pushback against them.
Right. So these statements that I take to be bigoted are earlier ones made. Congressman King, I know, said something that I thought was racist. Those things are not acceptable.
He was stripped of some committee seats, right?
Yeah, so something specifically was done toward him. And instantly, Congresswoman Omar's statements clearly do not represent the thinking of most anybody else in office in the Democratic Party. But if they start to mumble in response to her specific and clear anti-Semitic statement, then the party itself is going to be held more broadly accountable for having similar feelings, which I know they don't. So again, I say this is a moment of testing, moral testing. Speak clearly about it. Make clear to the congresswoman that she went over the line. It's unacceptable. And you make clear to the next person who's thinking about expressing some other kind of bigotry that is not going to be tolerated.
Yeah, and just moments ago, Debbie Wasserman Schultz said it's anti-Semitic tropes. Again, it just doesn't, they're not hitting back hard enough. But I do want to ask you about the Democratic Party and the upcoming 2020 election.
Yeah.
Again, it feels like there's a sort of a social justice movement, a sort of identity politics that's bubbling up, and it's going to probably play a major role and who's going to be the nominee for the party. You've got a big pushback against some of the establishment folks, and it could get ugly. I mean, where do you see this going right now?
Right. So in American politics, our two great parties say what they're about most clearly during the presidential nominating process, and that's what's happening now.
Really?
This
because
is a contest.
The narrative, Senator, is that they go too far to get the grassroots, and then they find a way back to the middle to win a general election.
So, but the door is open to either party for every registered Republican or Democrat to come out and vote in the primaries. Too often, it is that small so-called core constituency that has disproportionate influence. So you asked me about the Democratic Party. This is going to be a contest for the identity of the party once again. I hope the party remains a center-left party, which it's been at its most successful. If it goes over and becomes a far-left party, I don't think it's going to be able to elect a president in 2020.
How do they avoid it? In other words, who's going to be the leader that either tells the far left, which is a juggernaut, has all the momentum, that at the very least wait, let's not try to have a complete coup right now as we try to win this next election. Who's the person that can do this? Because we can see Nancy Pelosi's having a real tough time dealing with these new.
I want to start with Speaker Pelosi, because what's interesting to point out. And I was involved in trying to help some of the candidates, is that the Democrats took back the House not because of the more left candidates, but because of the centrist candidates who won in swing districts. So that's what's got to happen in the presidential primary.
Senator, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.